Random House Audiobooks presents Dr. Death by Jonathan Kellerman. Read for you by John Rubinstein.
Dr. Death. Irony can be a rich dessert. So, when the contents of the van were publicized, some people gorged. The ones who'd believed Eldon H. Mate to be the angel of death. Those who considered him mercy personified grieved. I viewed it through a different lens, had my own worries. Mate was murdered in the very early hours of a sour-smelling, fog-laden Monday in September. No earthquakes or wars interceded by sundown, so the death merited a lead story on the evening news. Newspaper headlines in the Times and the Daily News followed on Tuesday. TV dropped the story within 24 hours, but recaps ran in the Wednesday papers. In total, 4 days of coverage, the maximum in short attention span LA, unless the corpse is that of a princess or the killer can afford lawyers who yearn for Oscars. No easy solve on this one. No breaks of any kind. Milo had been doing his job long enough not to expect otherwise. He'd had an easy summer, catching a quartet of lovingly stupid homicides during July and August, one domestic violence taken to the horrible extreme, and three brain-dead drunks shooting other inebriates in squalid West Side bars. Four murderers hanging around long enough to be caught. It kept his solve rate high, made it a bit, but not much, easier to be the only openly gay detective in LAPD. "Knew I was due," he said. It was the Sunday after the murder when he phoned me at the house. Mate's corpse had been cold for 6 days, and the press had moved on. That suited Milo just fine. Like any artist, he craved solitude. He'd played his part by not giving the press anything to work with. Orders from the brass. One thing he and the brass could agree on. Reporters were almost always the enemy. What the papers had printed was squeezed out of clip-file biographies, the inevitable ethical debates, old photos, old quotes. Beyond the fact that Mate had been hooked up to his own killing machine, only the sketchiest details had been released. Van parked on a remote section of Mulholland Drive, discovery by hikers just after dawn. Dr. Death murdered. I knew more because Milo told me. The call came in at 8 p.m., just as Robin and I had finished dinner. I was out the door, holding on to the straining leash of Spike, our little French bulldog. Pooch and I both looking forward to a night walk up the glen. Robin answered the phone, caught me in time, ended up doing dog duty as I returned to my study. "Mate's yours?" I said, surprised because he hadn't told me sooner. Suddenly edgy because that added a whole new layer of complexity to my week. "Who else merits such blessing?" I laughed softly, feeling my shoulders humping, rings of tension around my neck. The moment I'd heard about Mate, I'd worried. Deliberated for a long time, finally made a call that hadn't been returned. I'd dropped the issue because there'd been no good reason not to. It really wasn't any of my business. Now, with Milo involved, all that had changed. I kept the worries to myself. His call had nothing to do with my problem. Coincidence, one of those nasty little overlaps. Or maybe there really are only 100 people in the world. His reason for getting in touch was simple, the dreaded W word, whodunit. A case with enough psychopathology to make me potentially useful. Also, I was his friend, one of the few people left in whom he could confide. The psychopathology part was fine with me. What bothered me was the friendship component. Things I knew but didn't tell him, couldn't tell him. I agreed to meet him at the crime scene the following Monday at 7:45 a.m. When he's at the West L.A. station, we usually travel together, but he was already scheduled for a 6:15 meeting downtown at Parker Center, so I drove myself. Mate had been butchered fairly close to my home, and I set out at 7:30. The first leg of the trip was 10 minutes north on Beverly Glen, the Seville fairly sailing, because I was going against traffic, ignoring the angry faces of commuters incarcerated by the southbound crush. At Mulholland, I turned left and drove 4 miles west, past seismically strained dream houses and empty lots that said optimism wasn't for everyone. The road coiled, scything through weeds, brush, saplings, other kindling, twisted upward sharply, and changed to packed ochre soil as the asphalt continued east and was renamed Encino Hills Drive. Up here at the top of the city, Mulholland had become a dirt road. I'd hiked here as a grad student, thrilling at the sight of antlered bucks, foxes, falcons, catching my breath at the furtive shifting of high grass that could be cougars. Milo was already there, his copper-colored unmarked pulled up in front of a warning sign posted by the county. 7 miles of unfinished road followed, no vehicles permitted. He hitched his pants, loped forward, took my hand in both of his giant mitts. Alex. Hey, big guy. He had on a fuzzy-looking green tweed jacket, brown twill pants, white shirt with a twisted collar, string tie with a big, misshapen turquoise clasp. Going cowboy? My George O'Keefe period. Natty. He gave a low, rumbling laugh, pushed a lick of dry black hair off his brow, squinted off to the right, focusing on a spot that told me exactly where the van had been found. I said, no attempt to conceal. He shrugged and jammed his hands in his pockets. He looked tired, washed out, worn down by violence and small print. Or maybe it was just the time of year. September can be a rotten month in L.A., throat-constrictingly hot or clammy cold, shadowed by a grimy marine layer that turns the city into a pile of soiled laundry. September light is bad for the complexion. Milo's didn't need any further erosion. The gray morning light fed his pallor and deepened the pockmarks that peppered his cheeks and ran down his neck. He'd gone back to drinking moderately, and his weight had stabilized. 240 was my guess, most of it settling around his middle. His jowls, always monumental, had given way around the edges. We were about the same age. He was 9 months older, so I supposed my jawline had surrendered a bit, too. I didn't spend much time looking in the mirror. He walked to the kill spot, and I followed. Faint chevrons of tire tracks corrugated the yellow soil. We took casts of the tracks, he said, flicking a hand at them. Not that it matters. We knew where the van came from. Rental sticker, Avis, Tarzana branch. Brown Ford Econoline with a nice big cargo area. Mate rented it last Friday, got the weekend rate. Preparing for another mercy mission, I said. That's what he uses vans for. But so far, no beneficiaries come forth claiming Mate stood him up. I'm surprised the companies still rent to him. Well, they probably don't. The paperwork was made out to someone else. Woman named Alice Zogby, president of the Socrates Club, Right to Die outfit, headquartered in Glendale. She's out of the country attending some sort of humanist convention in Amsterdam, left Saturday. She rented the van and split the next day, I said. Apparently. Called her home, which also doubles as a Socrates office, got voicemail. Had Glendale PD drive by, no one home. Zogby's message says she's due back in a week. She's on my to-do list. He tapped the pocket where his notepad nestled. I wonder why Mate never bought a van, I said. Well, from what I've seen so far, he was cheap. I tossed his apartment the day after the murder. Not much in the way of creature comforts. His personal car's an old Chevy that's seen better days. Before he went automotive, he used budget motels. I nodded. Bodies left on the bed for the cleaning crew to find next morning. Too many traumatized maids turned into bad publicity. I saw him on TV once getting defensive about it, saying Christ had been born in a barn full of goat dung, so setting doesn't matter. But it does, doesn't it? He looked at me. You've been following Mate's career? Didn't have to, I said, keeping my voice even. He wasn't exactly media shy. Any tracks of other cars nearby? He shook his head. So, I said, you're wondering if the killer drove up with Mate. Or parked farther down the road than we checked. Or left no tracks. That happens plenty. You know how seldom forensic stuff actually helps.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.